List.
No, I think we pretty much did it.
No, I think the balance is way too good right now.
Oh, Cursed Hollow.
Okay.
Raven pick, by the way. Raven picked Cursed Hollow despite losing, so they're going to give first pick over to L5.
By the way, Nova is not God tier. Well, Cursed Hollow, maybe they're going to pick some globals here as they're moving away from team fights. Few of the previous matches, and then now they're back onto their own old Raven form as they're going into Cursed Hollow. The name really shows it. The name shows itself
Raven
as
Raven Lord, man.
The Raven Lord will control and curse all the towers. I want to see some false stats happening here. And I also miss SDE's false stat too.
I wish we'd see some false stat in the series. I think Murky's more likely though. Head into this one with L5 having first pick. And let's see how they want to set us up. Draft is live. It'll be the Morales ban again. L5 taking this fully seriously. They need the 3-0. Will be the Oreo ban on the other side.
Seems like pretty standard.
First pick.
Has been the way for L5 only.
Oh, Samuro, we called it. We are gods.
Murky? This is a bug in Korean UI that if you pick at a weird timing, the voice line keeps on happening until you finish the pick. So
that's
we'll be hearing this for the rest of the time.
Could I? Could I?
this is a bug.
There's no way this is
2-0 though.
There's no
2-0, 100% win rate.
There's no way they picked him on purpose at the exact time where the bug would happen. That would be crazy. They would never do something like that.
We can't do anything. We can't fix it, guys. There's Rengar.
Yeah, don't get hyped. That's not a Rexar. That's a Rengar.
Rengar. Yes. Did I say Rexar?
No. I'm just saying, I'm saying anyone is out there watching thinking, oh, it's Rengar. No, it's Rengar.
I'm pretty sure they're, stop it already. Okay, we're moving on.
Okay, the voice is done, guys. Except if I do it a little bit later. Just because I want to. L5 could take the Grey Mane here with the Tyrael. Could also run Illidan. Zhang'a, the first player worldwide to popularize the hunt in 2016's Gold Club World Championship. That's where he used it on Warhead Junction as well as on this map. So something to keep in mind, like it could be Abathur Illidan. We could see something like that with the Tyrael already locked in. Good picks for the map. Could just be standard Grey Mane. Could be Sonya Genji, actually.
Sonya Genji. Okay, pretty good. Frontliner also solo lane along with Genji. They do have Tyrael already. So they had this in mind. With Sanctification just not being on the other side, Dragonblade can do tons of damage. Now Raven may have to think about double supports here, as there will be burst damage coming out from the other side. Uther is still a decent choice, I would say.
Well, it's going to be Samuro versus Sonya, which is like pretty good for Sonya, but it depends on how good of a Samuro we're going to see on the side of Raven. Mm-hmm. I don't even know who's going to play that. It could be Darvish. I get the feeling it's Darvish, but again, we've never seen them play it, so we don't know. Could be Hamon or Deong as well. Would definitely not be NMX. Well, could be Meridae as well, I guess. I'm like taking this draft too seriously. I'm like trying to think about this as if this was a real draft, but I think that...
It is a real draft, though.
Sure. but like... let's see what they try to pair with it, because like Samuro's not one of those like DPS carries that gains a lot from the Uther, you know, and we don't know if it's going to be double support yet. So this is a really tough ban for L5 because to be frank, like, I don't think anybody knows where this draft is going, not even Raven, so...
So, safety first, just ban whichever hero you think can be a threat. So I think it was a Garrosh ban. For the taunt, I think, if Genji goes in, if there's a taunt, big taunt, AoE taunt, Genji can be the target.
So... We need to see a DPS before we can know anything. Like, there's no way to know anything that's about to happen at all until we see a DPS locked in. If we see, like, a Vala come in, and we're like, okay, they need a second support. Sombra's just going to try to push top. It's going to be not global, but it is going to be top pressure and tribute control.
I think they're thinking in a way where they want to have lane pushed. And when we talk about lane pushing, not just Sombra. And we forgot this hero. Zul is an option.
I don't think that's going to happen, even though it'd be really funny. Let's see. Thinking hard on this one. What's going to be the next fun hero coming in here? Lock it in. Artanis. So maybe some more. Maybe some of that split pushing from him. Could actually end up being the soul laner. Samuro can roam. And the Li Ming for tribute poke, I guess, is the reason for this one. Our first Li Ming game of the day.
And the best skin, Arcane Li Ming. Artanis. They do have lots of frontliner along with the illusions. Maybe this will be another. Well, they do have a bruiser in the front line. So when they and when they picked Artanis, usually they went for a tankless team comp.
Yeah, it could be.
They may just do it again.
Yeah, it could be just Artanis is the quote unquote tank, but he's not really that much of a tank. Doesn't have tank kit as a bruiser kit. So L5 needs supports. Uther, a great option for them. I think the best option they could get for the Sonya. Question is, will it be hyper carry Genji or a second DPS? That's what they're trying to decide.
Falstad!
Well, there's your Falstad.
Yes!
Even weirder than a Murky pick. Not really. So solo support Karazim, double DPS. And I think this is going to be probably Palm, Karazim, because they don't have that much displacement. Seven Sided can be really strong for boss control.
Mm-hmm. They do have Sync.
For Raven, they need another DPS. Mm-hmm. They cannot make this happen with solo Li Ming. Will not work.
Well, things seem like Mary Day is communicating a lot through the comms.
Does seem that way.
And he's smiling. We already have Artanis and Samuro. We need some tanks along with the Li Ming.
Murky DPS? Come on. Gazlo? All right, give it to me. Jaina? I'll take it.
Jimmy?
Jimmy Raynor? Oh, okay. No, that's... Okay,
they will have a tank along with Rengar. Of
so...
Okay.
Solo DPS Li Ming, Artanis Muradin, Sombra top lane. This is a real HTC Pro match, guys. This is not a show match. This is not a trick. This is not a drill, okay?
It's not
this
a dream either.
This is real life. Okay, here we go. Let's find out if L5's pretty traditional old school double DPS comp can win out against the Sombra Artanis comp on the side of Raven. Right into Cursed Hollow. For game number two, let's find out if they could tie us up and knock L5 into the gauntlet. This is HGC Korea. In blue, Hooligan on Tyrael, SC on Genji, Jonga on Sonya, SDE on Falstad, and Swoy on Karazim.
And in red, Raven, Darvish on Muradin, Hamlin on Artanis, NMX on Li Ming, Diyoung on Rengar, Merry Day on Sombra.
Yep, we kind of thought this would be the case. Not because it makes sense, of course, but based on what we saw already with the Rexxar pick. So, A cool pick here for Falstad, by the way, with the Gathering Storm will work on Samuro clones, so you can actually gain a lot of stacks.
Yes, at least a lot more stacks.
I assume that's how it works. I've never actually tried it myself.
Yes, it does.
Because all other quest talents do work on the clones, so it's like that is going to be the reason why we see it here. Look, it gets, oh my god, so many stacks just then. Like four more stacks. Falstad's out of here. Peace out. Let me get that soak. Gonna use the globals here to get macro advantage. Let's see how Samuro is used, because we thought it might just be up on the top lane pushing, but looks like he's got ganks on the mine. Gonna try to gank down here, but Asiya and Sway are already on their way out. Or are they?
Samuro's coming in for the gank onto Sway. The stash is out.
Hyper mobile heroes down here, so unfortunately for Meridae, this is not going to be successful.
Boy, with those sprays, man. He love him.
Sway is definitely... He's doing the Rhaegar dance. He's doing the sprays. He knows what he wants. He wants this 3-0. He wants to get into the minds of Raven right now. Maybe make them make some weird picks or something like that. Good accuracy by NMX with reaction time by Sway. So, pretty even game so far. I feel like the... turning point will be when we get to those tributes. That's when things are going to start to go L5's way because of their global composition. They don't have the wave clear that Raven has. Raven can have better camp timings with Samuro, Artanis, and the Rhaegar pick. And the Karzeem's going to start the top one where they start red with Rhaegar.
Well, Samuro's going in, but is he going to be spotted?
This is actually a cool invade. He actually might steal this.
Thanks for leash.
Doesn't commit. Does bait a lot of the L5 members up.
Does force the rotation, but the mid lane was cleared anyhow. So they were just using the spare time to just spot. If they can catch a kill, great. But just being safe so they can take the camp back.
Cap already cleared for Raven. Camp coming in for L5, a much better timing, and it's also a lucky tribute for L5. The camp is going to push at the top with Falstad, who's global on the opposite side of the map. Uh-huh. I think Raven should just let this go. There's no reason to try to contest this against the Falstad. Just keep Samuro up in the top lane at least. Try to get some extra soak and bait this out. That could be one way to deal with it.
Yeah, after taking the giant, that's exactly what they're going to do, going for the tribute. Samuro is up there. Artanis is... not even considering of coming down.
I like this. Just delay a little bit and don't lose experience. Wanted to delay one more time. Maybe a bit overzealous here was Darvish. Great spear accuracy. Yeah. Beyond that mistake with Muradin, I think that was very good handling by Raven. Oh god, SD is getting so many stacks with this. This is insane.
He's happy to be leaning against Meridae Samuro there. That's exactly why Falstad did not come down. He did not have to. Of course, it was a 3v4 down there, anyhow. So they got the first tribute and this camp. And Raven does have some wave clear. And they do have the lane pushing power, but they're rotating too much, I would say.
Yeah.
Now they're finally going towards the right one. Samuro going down, Muradin staying on top. I think this is a better laning for Raven, which should have started with.
Yeah, I mean, the invade was a cool idea, the cap timing. That was interesting. It probably works a lot in solo queue, but...
Nice swap on the jungle. This could be a kill.
Okay. This will be the first kill for Raven. It's well done by Hamlet. But I do like this setup, as you say, much more. Samuro can put some pressure on the bot lane here. Again, tribute is going to be L5 favored in terms of spawn. Because not only is it far away from Falstad's split push, but it's also on the blue side of the map. So when Sonya respawns, this should be a great opportunity for L5. They're already going to start channeling with Sway here. He won't be able to get this, but they can set up now for the fly-in. Muradin staying top. And L5 should be able to delay this for a long time now that Sonya's coming back in. Okay, Hooligan is going to come in and interrupt. NMX already under fire here. Deong on the wrong side of the crater here. Whatever you want to call where that tribute is. NMX does get one more skill shot through, but that is going to be the channel that's curse point now. They didn't lose a ton of experience because Darvish is still up here, but this is not going to matter now, but it will matter when the third tribute comes in.
And also, even more when they are about to hit 10, I think this is close to the boss timing, 5 minute mark. L5 will be looking towards that boss timing very soon. Yeah. What is Merida doing on the other side? I think he is...
He's invading again. He's just
trying
to wait.
I think he's spotted, though. Yes.
Yep. No, I think that actually means he cannot be seen. That either. Don't think they know.
He was stealth throughout the watchtower, but I thought Kerosene had eyes on him. That's why he was also chasing. But
surprised. Well, I think if they had vision, they would have killed him, right? But I think he just wanted to try to hit that camp timing to invade. Like, he's playing a different kind of MOBA, because in this game we don't really see invades like that. But it doesn't really quite work out.
Oh my goodness, SDE! It Interland. Is last.
Okay.
Maybe we'll see Judgment coming in, locking in one target, and Genji can just have a fun time just swinging the blade.
They should have taken Crater if they were going to do that. Come on. What are they thinking? Crater,
Leap,
Hinterland.
Crater, Hinterland, yeah. Judgment, all the combos.
Oh, I don't know if we're going to get to 20. I guess maybe that's why I didn't want to get the Leap for the Crater. Still, Leap would have been incredible for this.
It is Judgment locked in from Hooligan.
Okay, this is an opportunity to kill NMX. He's going to be potentially the target, but already Merida is giving SDE some trouble here. The clones will do cooldown reduction for this Hinterlands. Already Sonya is dead. He needs to fire this Hinterlands. Does hit several here. Judgment is onto Deong here. Okay, palm well timed. Hooligan is going to go down, but we'll be able to add some additional damage into this one. But not going to hit the target he wanted, though.
Before that, there were too many kills, and NMX got reset. Another one here as Falset goes down.
More like a soft taco in this case is this composition. That was pretty poorly executed by L5.
If they had Sank there, I think they could have actually took the team fight easily with Sonya surviving that.
I mean, that was actually a good play by Merida. Like, he got on top of SDE and made it very difficult for him to position the way he wanted to. Sonya died early in the fight, which meant that they just didn't really have that much tanking, obviously, with no sanctification. This team is kind of not really, like, it's not even really tank material here. You know, it doesn't have the ability to kind of peel and give that opportunity for everyone to survive with the sank. Hinterland Blast hit almost everybody, so the cooldown was massively reduced and is going to be available again for the next fight. But Raven takes an experience lead briefly here, and they might have a window back into this game.
And they do have a tribute. Maybe they just thought palm was enough, and they're going for this invade, but this will be... L5 will be happy to trade the boss and the tribute.
Yeah, this is...
This is a bad trade for Raven, for sure.
This is kind of a weak, desperate play. The boss would go straight to the fort. It's not like this is threatening a keep wall. Whereas, because of the top push here, the boss for L5 that they take will go to the keep faster with Curse, as you said. So... I mean, they can invade here with Merida if they want, take the Night Camp, but again, the Night Camp's not going to be pushing anything. We'll mitigate the power of the curse in mid lane, but the fact that they will likely get a keep from this is enough for L5. They're very happy with this trade. Okay, Darvish a little bit late on this one, is going to get Judgment. It does actually commit the combo here. The Avatar saves him for a moment. A lot of resources spent to get him, but they do get the kill during Curse, and the boss is moving towards that keep now.
Also a little early Ancestral, even though it was a good one for sure. The maximum damage came out from the L5, and we also have the boss full health because of the Curse. Maybe they will get the keep, and to the core even if they push in.
I think there's a high chance. Hamlin's under attack here. Murden up in three. Blind coming through. Not going to help him against the Dragonblade, though. Merida is under fire here. We'll have to leave. Palm ignored very well by NMX, but still, SDE survives until Merida gets those basic attacks off here. Deong is the next target. Gets into the Hall of Storms. Attacking this core is a risky proposition here. The boss doesn't have as much scaling as it would have in the later stages of the game. Tyrael going to add some extra damage here. I think they still get this core, but it was a closer call than they would have liked. That's going to be the win here for L5, taking that 2-0 lead in some pretty spectacular fashion, I guess you could say.
Even with that Samuro, they had a window of coming back. Slight window? L5 with the dominant win, taking a better trade with the boss, with the curse, going straight from the forward to the keep to the core. And that was easy. And compared to that, Raven's boss didn't even do much on the other side. Not the best decision making right there.
But I think that's a pretty good summary of the boss exchange there. And I'd have to watch it again and even really probably have to hear the comms to know why they made that decision. Because that's one of those decisions that feels baffling as a spectator where you're like, when we have all the information, you're like, well, why in the world would they make this decision? But maybe they were already rotating down. They realized too late and they were like, and then maybe it was disagreement in comms. I don't know, but
maybe the moment they decided to go down, the tribute spawned. And
yeah, that's definitely
part of it. They couldn't really go back. I guess that was a timing issue.
Sure. It might have been their best possible trade, even though it was so bad. Either way, it's 2-0 for L5. One more win, and we are done with regular season. And L5 will go to the tiebreakers. We'll see you guys in just a few to see if that third win is going to go over to L5.